So it's a real pleasure to introduce Jenny Cromwell and Anna Johnson from Sweden. And Jenny has been with Atrium, a visiting fellow at Atrium in the past. And I think everybody in this room knows Jenny quite well. So I'm not going to spend any further time, but thank you.
Yeah, we are very excited to be here. So thank you very much for And we are going to talk about our conservation project, that's the Global Textile Trade. The research. That's a very good
question.
But that's more fun. So it's a 3 or 4 year research project financed by a Swedish research company, looking at whether Tirupur is on a sustainable development path or not. And, of course, it's not. We all know, but we'll come back. We'll kind of complicate the picture. And this is a map of the study area. It's Tirupur City, Tirupur district, but also the nearby districts of Irod and Tarum, because we see them as a part of the Tirupur region. The textile cluster, export cluster of Tirupur.
And in fact, if you go upstream, of course, Bangalore is part of this whole picture, and the west, where we come from, as in the global textile trade.
And this is the way we are going to organize the presentation. We will try to do to tell you the story of the project so far, of our journey through the project. So we'll start in 2014 in points of departure, where we came from when we started writing the application. And then we'll tell you for every year some main points. So empirical material that we have gathered and conclusions and So my point of departure is that I'm an economist. I did my thesis in 1996 called Food and Fashion on the textile cluster. And at that time, the theory of theories concerning natural resource management, the tragedy of the commons, and collective action, and the possibilities and difficulties with collective action were very modern. So I got on to that train. And so the whole thesis is trying to look at water resource management as a collective action by them. So I was looking at irrigated agriculture in the lower district, but also at textile effluent management. And at that time, the discussions about migrants, and I saw it very natural to frame a common as a commons dilemma, as people have to contribute to some a common good, but it was not really for the good, it was not giving them individually advantages, it was for a larger good of society. So I think it worked quite well to put these common investments facilities as a common style. And my conclusion in the thesis was that the tragedy of the commons were mainly avoided. The seed is at when I left, at that time, the funds for the treatment facilities had been collected from the participants, and construction was just about to start. So basically, the tragedy was, they were able to get out of the tragedy traps. And why was that? I think it was a combination of a balance between the local community, the textile industrialists, or the dyers and weavers, their groups, the dyers association, and the different industries connected to each community. It was a balance between them and the state, and the kind of power that the state had through the community. There were a lot of negotiations over the years. So the state was pressurizing and the dyers were fighting back and organizing, but at the same time as they were organizing, they were actually organizing themselves in a way so that they could take on the sea projects as a collective. So that kind of power balance solved some of the common challenges. So when I left, the work on the CTPs had more or less started. The money was there, and the work was initially advised. And you can see that this dance balance between the state and the community had resulted in there were quite a lot of corruption involved in that relationship. So I left there 20 years ago. But then I had several students over the years, and in 2014 I had a master's student, a very good follow-up study on washing dirty laundry, and of course he found out at that time 18 CNTPs were there, they were running. Water was treated, a lot of effort was treated with certain technology. But when it was treated, there was a byproduct, the sludge, and that problem was visible everywhere in the city, and it's not yet solved, as far as we know. And he also could see that the corruption of the institution are in the way. John?
And no, they're Dania.
Is it?
Yeah,
no, it's Dania.
So as Lina said, I was here in 2008, 2009 as a fellow, and I actually started coming to India in 2003. Then I did my PhD with Bangalore as my case study, and from then onwards, I basically adopted Bangalore as my second town. I love coming back here. In between, I was also doing Then I joined CIWI, this Submit International Water Institute, in 2013. And they had this pilot project called SWAR, Sustainable Water Resources Management. And this was a unique project in very many ways, because it looked at the textile industry. And it was financed or co-financed by SIDA, the Swedish International Development Corporation Agency. So the money came from there, but three large Swedish brands, not the very largest, but the three next largest ones, they contributed with their time. And they nominated their suppliers or selected the suppliers in the Delhi region and the Delhi region. And in turn, those suppliers, they nominated some of their sub-suppliers. So this was unique in that kind of collaboration with CIWI as the facilitator in between and a very, very good consultant based in Delhi. So the brands and the factories, they contributed with their time, their interest, their willingness to create change. And we then was involved in two tiers of the textile value chain. So the suppliers, which is the same as the manufacturers or stitching unit, where at most you could say that the impact on the water environment.
Anna. It happened.
Anna. the impact on the water and environment is mainly if there is washing taking place of the finalized items and goods before export or before for leaving the country. But the majority of the impact on the environment is at the sub-supplier side and further up the value chain. So the wet processing, which involves dyeing and bleaching and finishing processes, and you have wet processing units of various different sizes, from the very, very large ones to the very small ones, which are sub-suppliers. Some of them are only doing dyeing of buttons or zippers and things like that. And they very often operate out of residential homes, and they emit their discharges very often straight through the municipal sewage network, and it's not being treated at all. And it's so far off and so hidden that no one sort of reaches them. They're not in control. So they were not part of this pilot project, and they are normally not part of anyone's sort of, they're out of reach of control. And it's very convenient for the brands to say that we only have business relationships directly with the supplier side, so the first tier. And sometimes we find vertically integrated factories where you have everything from spinning to the wet processing, to the garment stitching, packaging, and then sending off. But those factories are so far relatively few in India, whereas in China, for instance, it's much more common to find this. So the aims of this was to improve water management and also resources management of chemicals and energy. And more importantly, it was to build capacity and achieve a change in mindset, build knowledge, know-how and understanding over the long run at the sort of factory floor, from the very like labor level up to the manager owners. And what was important in terms of my point of departure was that I got to understand so much about these different value chain steps. And I visited a lot of factories and electricity plants. And so when Anna came in from her PhD side with all that background insight, I came in from this side and from knowing that there are so many stumbling blocks, but that there are also a lot of, there's a lot of willingness to some extent among some in the textile value chain. And that was my hope, that was my vision, that we were gonna be part of this whole change with this research project. So we had a lot of background knowledge when we came into this, and we framed the research application together with Veena and Sharad. And also we actually had H&M along there as a partner that was going to work pro bono together with us. For various different reasons that we're not going to dwell upon now, that collaboration never became. In turn, the collaboration with you guys has become fantastic. And Anna and I have visited at least once a year to have you as a sounding board. We've gathered a lot of fantastic advice and insight from you, and we are so thankful for that. So in terms of this presentation, because this is going to be about our journey, we can't go into all the details of all our findings, our analysis. So in terms of this, our journey, two research questions. So in this time kind of diagram, on the y-axis, we're going to see how our findings, our trust and confidence in ZLD, zero liquid discharge as a technique, and standards as a governance instrument, how that sort of changed over time, along with our increased awareness, understanding, frustration, and so on. So quickly then about zero liquid discharge. I had a presentation about this at the INSEE conference at the beginning of 2016. And to just like briefly summarize, these are some pictures that I've taken, some of them, and that one is from 2011. And the zero liquid discharge is a tertiary step of wastewater treatment. So you have the biological, et cetera, et cetera, primary and secondary wastewater treatment steps, that is conventional ones where you can take away the dye, the color of the dye. But you can never get away with it, the fixing salt through primary or secondary treatment. So to do that, you need to go into the tertiary step. And the tertiary step can lead to what is called zero liquid discharge. That does not equal that 100% is recycled. You always lose some water, some liquid from evaporation along the way. But depending on how efficient you are, the level of your knowledge, know-how, how good dye masters, how good treatment plans, staff you have, you can optimize this. And you can tweak the different steps and the different machinery and so on to reach a higher degree of recycling of water. But you have several different steps, and you normally combine, for instance, ultrafiltration, microfiltration, and several steps of RO membranes. And there is where the biggest cost lies. Because RO membranes, for all of you who have RO devices at home to treat your drinking water, they are very costly. You need to replace them time and again. And with a lot of salt contents in the influent water, they clog up very quickly, and then you need to replace them. And some people are tricked into buying very many of those, like you have like 5, 6, 7 different membrane filters after the other. And it goes through again and again and again. But for every step, it gets more pure. And then you do reject management again on this. And the final step is, for instance, with multiple effect evaporators. And if you use this kind of technique, and if you use Glauber's salt instead of nitrium chloride for your fixing salt, then you can recover this salt. And this is not the same type of salt that we put in our food. It's a special type of fixing salt that has, it is more expensive to buy, but you can recover very, very large amounts of it and just reuse this. And solar evaporation pans is often the very, very final stage, where in a climate such as that in Tidipur, you can evaporate and have a final sort of sludge at the bottom there. And after this, my first year of investigation, and which I told you about at the INSEE conference, and which is also told about in this paper that was published last year by Anamit, I go through what I then understood, my early findings about zero liquid discharge, and what incentives and disincentives is there for uptake of zero liquid discharge in a context such as that. So there are always going to be high capital expenditure and operational expenditures, and especially the latter one for the energy cost, because it is very energy costly to do the reverse osmosis. And you will need firewood, you will need electricity, you will need diesel, you will need, you name it. And increasingly now, coal is being used. So, and you need skilled manpower, as I mentioned. And you also have the trade-off with greenhouse gas emissions and a lot of air pollution. In order to make ZLD attractive financially, rather than just doing emitting as usual, you need to take into account the regulatory risk. This is what I found initially in this study. So you need to have a legislative control by the executive, the Pollution Control Board. And that needs to include from the raw water sourcing down to the wastewater handling and beyond. And you need what I call creative enforcement. And in Tidipur, that was actually the case, that because of the 2011 closing order, and before that, the expert committee and the monitoring committee that had been put in place, they were not just doing regular conventional enforcement. They actually added a lot of different ways of ensuring that compliance was there. It seemed to work, I thought at the time. Because there were everything from nighttime surprise inspections to online monitoring, etc. We heard of very many different ways of controlling that ZLD was actually achieved to the maximum. ZLD also requires constant R&D, research and development, because you need to tweak, you need to find optimized ways of actually doing the evaporation, for instance, or can you put some filtration before the RO steps and so on to reduce the cost, ensure that you have a better technology and cost effective time. You need training and you need to ensure that there's hand holding from the executive, which also actually seem to be there with guidelines coming out from the CPCB, for instance. Also, very important, and that was there and nowhere else. The raw water was paid for because from 2005, NTADCL started distributing pre-treated water to these companies. Lots of other factors involved in this, but the factories, they paid for their water rather than just taking groundwater, which is simply just pumped up. Again, this is a very simplified picture, but the point is that they paid for their water. At the start, they paid 45 rupees per cubic meter, and the latest figure we have heard is 78 rupees. But this has fluctuated both up and down. And again, can't really go into details there. Now I will hand over to Anna again.
My first year in project, or the history method, I suppose. Some of you have worked with that. I think there are lots of work of that. When I was sitting for my piece, I interviewed my textile industry. So now when I came back, 5 years later, I actually sought and tried to find each and every one of them. And some had gone out of business, some had just disappeared, some didn't see me. But I actually managed, right now, I managed to 15 out of my only 4 customers. That's really, I'm so happy. And I have a person who has helped me with the contact, so I'm really, really happy. So I've talked to about 15 wood informants and new informants. And actually some sons of my own. It's really covers some time now. We have also interviewed oral history interviews. A number of farmers affected by the pollution. Downstream Maya River, also in Kashmir, to a number of farmers. And then Jenny mainly has some households in Tilburg with women, household. Female heads, so to speak, or in charge of household water management, who has lived in Tirupur for a long time. Because since the city is growing so fast and has been doing, it's very important that you don't take someone who just came there. So I think we have gone back to the 70s, 60s in some cases. Life stories back to this about water management.
You said it was only households in Peru, but actually it's very important to point out that it was also households in by the Uratapalian Dam, which is downstream oil, and in this difficult part, which is north of Tirupur, below the Tirupur water. So households there as well, and because they're part of this, the Tirupur region.
And normally, or at least I've seen a lot of sources recommending that for three, you should try to aid the informant to remember events that happened a long time ago by asking him or her to refer to, okay, so which year were you married, and what happened then? You were concerning the issue that you're interested in. And we tried that, but we also had prepared a kind of water milestone or timeline. And it actually turned out that with all three groups, even households, right, that these were actually more important than marriage, first sunburst and stuff like that. So I just tell you very briefly what they stand for. So in the 1980s, at some point, the first truck Frontier Fur went out in the countryside outside, took water from the bore well and transported it back into Tier 4 to a dying. We don't know exactly which one, but during the 80s, that water management practice was growing very small because the low of the groundwater was bad. So that's kind of one milestone, that water started being trucked into the Tier 4. Then in the 1990s, we had the Women and Development Plans discussions that I was leading, which of course affected mainly the industrial. Then in 2005, World Bank and the Tier 4 Industrial Business financed a water supply project. Started working, taking water from Bavani, which is where the recovery the Bavani River. So it was a public-private partnership project, and the main users of that water was the textile industry. And then some water would be given to households, but that was kind of to be initiated.
And it says L&T because everyone there calls it L&T.
Because the consultant loves an Antuco project. So it's L&T water.
L&T is, yeah.
And then in 2011, the whole wet processing sector of Tirco was actually closed down overnight. It was today.
Yesterday.
But 7 years ago, because of the closure notice issued by the
Madras High Court,
and it was actually extremely efficient. All the units, and I think that everyone who were there, because it didn't affect water directly. But hundreds of thousands of workers lost their jobs overnight, just migrated back to where they came from. And the exporters were horrified because they had orders to meet the deadlines to their buyers. So they sent fabrics all over India, basically, even up to Delhi, Ludhiana. Or so it was a very traumatic situation. And then, so these we have used in the oral history interviews, and they have worked very well. Then, spring last year, out in this area. And we think that this might also be a kind of milestone or maybe a litmus test of how well the SEDLD actually worked and how household, whether they got priority water delivery or industry and so on from the project. So we want to, that's what we're going to investigate during this project. And all the time, we use this regenerative question. How did you, the informant, secure the water that you needed for your activities? Whether it was wet processing, or agriculture, or also processing. And this material we've used in our analysis so far to answer some of the research questions, but mainly they will be used to narrate the story Tilburg as a seat of life and water. I will say a couple of words about it later. So, yes. It's very confusing to have that, Jenny. Why do we have it? Anyway, then you wonder, okay, we have this question. What is the potential? To what extent can green standards contribute to a sustainable development? Because when you look at the, like Jenny said before, we study Tilburg and the Tilburg region and the effects that the export industry has had on the environment and the lives of people there. But you can't study that region in isolation from where the end consumers are. And in the media, in Europe, there is quite a lot articulated on consumers' demand for corporate social responsibility, particularly for the fast fashion. There are a lot of very bad press already. And partly as a response to that, labels have been developed during the last, I would say, 15 years. To kind of ensure the consumer that, okay, this is a green t-shirt, green in some aspect at least. So then I wanted to look at green standard as a global governance mechanism for greening the textile industry. So I started to do a mapping basically of the green standards that exist globally with relevance for textile. And the result was that I could find 39 standards, different standards, which could be relevant for a supplier to apply. But you see that most of them have very, very low use or market shares in this diagram. We also carried out the questionnaires, suppliers in Tilburg and buyers in Stockholm, to see how extent they actually used standards. So you can see that these were the most, those with highest use or highest market share.
In the interest of time, I'm going to speed up a little bit. While Anna was focusing on the standards in 2016, I focused on zero liquid discharge and how it was regulated. And I was lucky, in a way, because at the end of 2015, there was a reform in the making. So in October, approximately this year, there was a draft notification that came out from the Ministry of Environment. And according to this draft, zero liquid discharge and either individual treatment plants or CETPs would be mandatory for all wet processing units that were discharging more than 25 kiloliters per day, which means that all wet processing units, except for the very, very small zipper dyers, would be included in this, and it would be mandatory for them, and they would have to cluster and everything. It was actually very, very far-reaching. And to be honest, I was thrilled when I saw this draft. Then 1 year, almost exactly, of lobbying took place. I did my fair share of lobbying as far as I could. I took a bit of an active research role there rather than being just a passive observer. And I described the process and the outcome of this regulatory reform in this paper, which is also available online. And no, long way. I'm not going to go into detail, but needless to say, maybe, or it wasn't too surprising, but the result, the amended rules to the Environmental Protection Act was very, very watered down. And by now, it is essentially up to the State Pollution Control Board to decide whether to make ZLD mandatory for the large vehicles and other kinds of textile factories. They are not included. So, if we now jump to 2017, that was a year when I spent 1 month in Tirupur and here. And for me, that was where and when my frustration peaked, really. Because spending a whole month in the field is a luxury these days, but that is the only way to uncover and really go into depth and revisit again and again and open up networks and getting referred and having snowballing into, like, doors are open for you when you have a bit more extended time in the field and you also have a good bit of pre-understanding. So if I had been positive that ZLD could work and that it was implemented until then, I felt a lot of pessimism, partly also because of what was happening in Tamil Nadu at the time. So there was a lot of political turmoil, as you know. The Chief Minister Jayalalitha expired, basically. There was a fight as to who would take over after that. And it seemed as if no one was very optimistic about the future. It seemed as if all this political turmoil led to increased corruption, that bribes were basically siphoned up from units who were visited regularly. And for a single little spider web in the corner, they would have to pay a little something. And all of that money needed to go up to the party. And it seemed as if this in turn meant less of enforcement from the PCP side. So the discharge rules and the ZLD were not enforced as much as before. This is my understanding of what has happened. This is something that can never be proven. This is anecdotal evidence. This is part of the very messy, messy context that Tirupur provides, and which the entire global textile value chains provide us with. We can never say that we know for certain, and that is why, partly why I was so extremely frustrated. But I was also extremely upset, because I saw so much of pollution and saw so many people in despair, because they could not farm anything. The food production was just out of the picture because the groundwater was so bad. Etc. So the local areas were affected because of the prevalence of injection wells, where wastewater is basically just dumped into the ground, and of illegal nighttime discharges into the Noyon, blending with the sewage water and reaching up, basically mostly affecting downstream users by the Oratapalya Dam, where there's like the dam is still there, there's no storage anymore, but the dam water, it sort of sits there and permeates down, and it destroys the aquifers and the groundwater there. And as you know, there was also a water war between Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. Not the first time, not the last time, but it was there. And we're in the middle of a drought, a bad drought here. And another thing that came to me in terms of anecdotal information from many, and which I could sort of confirm when I came back to Sweden and spoke to buyers, was that quite many buyers were saying that, well, as of lately, we see that the output quality of the dyed goods is not that good anymore. We agree on a certain color let's say this year's fashion is this green, and we agree on a recipe for the dyeing, but then when we get the batch of clothes back, it's this green, and that's not what I ordered. So the dyer will need to redo everything at his cost, of course, but I as a buyer lose time, and I lose patience, and I lose trust in this dyer, who I maybe used for many, many years. So there are rejects, increasing cases of rejects. And I actually heard a few buyers saying that I don't source from Tilbury. It's too costly, I can't trust them, I can't trust the output quality. Now when we spoke about this, I came to realize that apparently groundwater has started to be used again. So instead of this NTA DCL water, which they had to pay for, and which was like mandatory to use, now that wasn't really used anymore, and possibly because there wasn't so much enforcement of the rules anymore. And because it became cheaper to use their own groundwater and tanker in groundwater from various different places. So the TES level of all these different sources of groundwater would be different. And hence the output quality would differ from time to time. And that's why you have different depending on what source water you use. So all of this seemed to come together in a kind of perfect storm. And I also seemed to, I was very frustrated because it seemed that the buyers, they didn't know anything about this and they didn't ask. And I thought that trust is good, but control is better. And I was trying to advise buyers and brands in Europe and Sweden and so on, just like, ask the questions, show that you are interested in what's happening on the ground. Because the local guys at the buy houses and those that the brands are in contact with, they know of all those problems. They know of the injection wells, they know about the groundwater that's being sourced from different areas. They know what is taking place. And they will ask. They will tell you if you just ask. But the buyers, they don't ask. Because I think to them, ignorance is often bliss. And they don't think about asking either. And then I've come to understand more and more, of course, that it's not as simple as the brands only asking and being ignorant. It is also the fact that even if they were to ask, even if they were prepared to pay more for proper wastewater treatment and actual zero liquid discharge, the corruption is going to be there at the end of the day anyway. So we end up with having technical, et cetera, issues around zero liquid discharge. So it is not the silver bullet. Maybe it is for some, maybe it can really, really work for some, but it is not, we cannot generalize. And that was my 2017, so to say.
And what about the standards then? The 39 different standards. When I analyzed the data and the interview material as well, I came to the conclusion that this amount, this high number of standards, they were actually in a standard score where everyone was confused because they didn't know what different standards stood for and which standards would be best to certify according to, because it was a very, very fragmented supply of standards along the value chain. What was certified? Was it the cotton in the t-shirt? Was it the process where the t-shirt was produced? Or was it the chemical content of the t-shirt itself? And actually, a lot of standards focus on the end product and what kind of dangerous chemical that contains. There was also a geographical fragmentation. It seems like almost every European country has their own kind of green label, Swedish green label and Dutch green label, German green label, sometimes even like the Swedish green label or a Dutch green label working in Bangladesh, particularly. That label was only used in Bangladesh, like packed. So very, very fussy, And then we also have a very different level of ambition between that. So just because there is a green leaf, maybe, on something, doesn't really mean that the standard has taken issues of groundwater, for example, into account. But very, very often, the criteria of the standards are limited to the factory or the chemical content, the chemicals used in the process. But they don't look outside the factory to see what effects on the whole hydrological system. And then there is also fragmentation in terms of pregnancy. How well is criteria controlled? Is it the company itself who said, yeah, we apply these criteria, we get the standard, because there are standards like that? Or is it a third party auditor? We could also see that there is a growing business, a big business. There is a lot of money in auditing. That's, I think, is interesting itself. Because the auditors, they want even more standards. Because then they can have more contracts for auditing. And this is a citation from Lars Dyer, that we've met several times. He says that our establishment got approved. We work with SAA 8000, which is a social standard, but still standard that they work with. We are working with the BSCI, the European market, and the RAP for the US market. Here's the geographical presentation. And then we have two buyers that have their own requirements, like those standards. And we also work with Ecotex. So we're working with seven different certifications. And of course, the cost for certification and auditing. And then we have this European buyer working with big companies for several years. And she just said, she knows this. And she just said, we don't give this extra. So she asked for certification. They were not willing. Of course, this cost comes extra. So it seems like green standards, maybe they are one small part of the puzzle, but they are not like the silver bullet. It's a bit problematic. They're not the solution of the problem. And now this year, I'm going to work with oral history material, trying to look on the development pathway of Tirupur from the industrialist perspective when it comes to the economic sustainability of water, farmers when it comes to ecological system and farming, or ex-farmers. Some of them will be ex-farmers. They can't farm anymore. And then households, by focusing on slum households, I try to capture the equity or social sustainability aspect of development. And kind of the question to the material is, okay, has the growth and development paradigm delivered? And is it on its way of being replaced by the sustainable development paradigm, or according to the agenda 2030? And my hypothesis is that the answer is partly, and no, maybe just starting from what I have seen so far. But it'd be very, I think it's a relevant question. Let's see, where are we now? I think it's you.
Yes. Okay, so I spent last week in Tirupur and went on bus tonight. This is the final round of the work now. And last year, I also started to look into the UN guiding principles on corporate business and its responsibility to respect the human right to treat people. And this is something we basically added to, it wasn't there as a research question in the application, but it seems relevant because this is something that is talked about more and more. And for various reasons, I think, well, you don't really find anyone who's done a study into the textiles value chain and the UNGP before, and the responsibility of the corporate sector. And I'm starting to understand why, because I have reached out to a number of actors on the value chain, from factories, producers, to middlemen buyhouses, to buyers. And some of them show a lot of interest to a certain extent. So again, I take an active role and I advise on what this UNDP means and what different steps that they can take, baby steps to go towards better responsibility taken to actually respect human rights to drink water. But I do understand actually that for like basically everyone along this value chain, to start to gain a better understanding and knowledge backwards up the value chain about what those before you are actually doing and not doing, that is very, very burdensome. We can do it because we have research knowledge to do it, and we can like put our hearts into this in a lot of time. But for business on an extremely competitive global market where brands are going out of business like every day. In Sweden, that happens all the time. It is very, very burdensome to them. And so I'm not sure if I'm actually going to reach there at the end of the day to write a whole paper on this, because I have no results, but it's very difficult to pull that into an entire paper. But I've also been looking into a lot of this with corporate water risk management, because at the Davos meeting, that is always like among the five top threats, water access or water availability is framed in different ways every year, but it's always on the top five. So in theory, companies in the corporate world, they are weaving water into the fabric of their being. And it is said that water is a boardroom issue these days. And it sounds very nice, right? It sounds like as if the corporate sector is actually really using their leverage and taking their responsibility little by little. They're really understanding the threats with climate change, variability, increasing allocation difficulties, the problems with more and more people on this earth and different sectors needing water for various reasons. But what I did find was that, well, very well, you see this kind of like bullet points that would explain risks and threats, why you need to take water into account. So you would have reputational threat, that you would have protests from Greenpeace, for instance, regarding water pollution, and from end consumers, like Anna was saying, bad press. Local communities in the city of Perundurai, for instance, there was so much local protest that Coca-Cola could not put on the factory there. End of story for them. And you have protests from farmers, agricultural sector, food producers, big and small, and other sectors, of course, that are competing for the same water resources, quality-wise and quantity-wise. So that is a risk that you need to deal with and take into account. Then you have the legislature, as I mentioned before, the regulatory risk, the risk that all of a sudden there's a draft amendment to the rules and they're going to require that the entire business has seed fees as a duty, and then at the end of the day that's not so risky at all, but it's still there. The liabilities, so if you can't deliver on time or if you need to do re-dyes because the end output is not what the buyer ordered, that is a liability threat and late deliveries and so on, like what happened in 2011 when 700 of the wet processing units were closed down. But most important, of course, the water availability, because of climate change and unpredictability, but also because of, for instance, water wars.
And now we are in Bangalore, but being in Tirupur, you are very much aware of how urban interests chop over downstream interest from agriculture and other users. That is a fact, and there's much more political clout being in Bangalore and Austria. So that is, of course, from a water availability quantitative point of view, a big risk that should be taken into consideration. And I thought when I came last week that the drought in April onwards would possibly have had some kind of impact, that there would possibly be production stops, because the NTADCL was ordered by the collector, do not distribute to the industries, prioritize domestic users. So that was the information we had received sitting in Sweden. And we had tried to confirm that with our assistants and other different contacts we had on the ground. And it seemed to us, it seems to me when I came last week, that, okay, this is the new point of departure, that water was really a risk. And I also understood last year when I spoke to a lot of buyers, they had no clue, absolutely no clue about that, oh, there is worse drought in 142 years, and oh, could that possibly have an impact? Oh, I haven't heard that. And so from the tentative conclusions I draw from last week, I'm very confused. I've been telling Anna how, like, I don't understand. Like, we spoke about that at lunch, some of us, how when I ask people about, like, villagers and slum dwellers in Tirupur and so on, like, how was last year in terms of your water access? Good monsoon, very good monsoon. And then I probe, wasn't there a drought? Didn't we have some problems before that in the summer? And then those who live downstream by Orosabalion, they don't forget, because they have the most difficult situation of them all. In Tirupur, yes, they still got the empty water less often, but then there were tankers. They could even either buy tanker water, or there was tanker water supplied by the municipality. So, like before, being in Tirupur means that your water access, your human right to drinking water, is actually well provided for compared to in the Sipkot area, compared to downstream by the river. But I also found, as it seems, we still need to ask very many questions about this, but it seems as if the LNT water was still provided to the industries. Possibly they provided groundwater instead. And maybe not as so often. And definitely, there was much more tanker water coming. But as one person said to me, well, we didn't get as many visits during this time, meaning the PCB didn't come as they wanted. So was there an understanding somewhere? Precarious situation, business must go on. Jobs must not be lost. And it seems that the only jobs that got lost last year was because of the GST. And that also complicates the situation, because now everyone talks about the GST and how that has affected the business. So water, and that's why I'm thinking about the situation as everyone is resilient. In the interest of time, I'm just going to flip through some pictures. If you can see, this is from the same area. This water is stark red, and it's not because of iron or rust. It's groundwater that's polluted from the industrial effluents. And this has been going on for very many years. And this man used to be a farmer. Now he can only rely on his rain-fed crop. And he can't even grow fodder for his cows because they have become infertile because of the effluents. This is from a scroll in August 2016, so 1.5 years back. Can the courts save India's rivers from pollution? The report shows the answer is no. And I can only agree. So there's a wide implementation gap.
In terms of bad press or whatever you want to call it, because I'm also starting to understand whether there is media article on this or not. There's so much politics in that. If we see certain articles now, it is because, for instance, the Kanataka elections, or because there is a by-election somewhere in Tamil Nadu, and there's some politician who wants to push a certain issue. And we also know that so many journalists are self-censoring. We are self-censoring. There's so much that we don't talk about because we cannot. Because I want to get home alive, I want to be able to come back to India with a visa in my passport. But journalists are being murdered here and in other countries for environmental pollution questions and what they report on. So all of this with PCB or disclosure, revokes closure because, oh, it was just an accident. The CGP did not involve. So to sum up, as you realize, we have only touched upon very simple things, and we chose to sort of narrate what we have done and our findings as a journey, like where we have been in our understanding. We could have narrated this in very many different ways. But if we started in 2014 and 2015, based on our points of departure and our pre-understanding, then our sort of confidence in that the world prospects are contributing to sustainable Tirupur by means of standards, by means of their liquid discharge as a tech fix. We sort of believed in that. And both for the standards and for the ZLDs, I started to wean. And then somewhere here, it was really, really at a low. And then now, last week, and this coming week, we're going to probe more into this with the drought. And I think my confidence in ZLD has possibly, yeah, maybe gained a little bit again, because I just cannot believe that, well, I do believe that it can work. And it really depends on the incentives and the disincentives. We know nothing about what's going to happen tomorrow. We know nothing about the monsoons this year. The southwest monsoon, with all likelihood, is not going to come and reach you. Whereas the northeast monsoon will it be a good monsoon? Will it be average? Or no one knows. And the year after that, no one knows. And no one knows what kind of politicians we're going to have there and how strict they are going to be and what kind of order that they are going to give. And we don't know what happens with enforcement of not to use groundwater and only use NTADCL. Because the price of the raw water is one of the most influential bits and pieces in the whole ZLD puzzle, whether it's going to be attractive financially or not. And when it comes to the standards, and I'm still working a little bit on the analysis.
But I would say that when you look at the confusion and the fragmentation that is here at the moment among the standards, and then you see that there are some initiatives trying to create meta standards for the standards. And those even add on to the confusion. Because no one kind of becomes the market leader of standards, which in a way is good, because the discussion about what the standards should be and the criteria goes on. But they really don't. There's too high transaction costs for them to be efficient. And they don't look outside. But I mean, at a global scale, because we are discussing, we are studying Tirupur, which is extreme, but it's not unique. And we have also been discussing that a lot of companies, a lot of buyers are starting to source in Africa, Asia, and also India and Chinese investors. Investing. So can ZLD maybe be a solution there if the right incentive structures
can be constructed?
So that's it. We still have a lot of questions. Yeah,
a lot of questions, question mark. And I personally feel that there are so many, when we finalize this, there's still going to be so many question marks that can't be straightened out, because as much as we try to triangulate, we cannot say that we really understand that we have seen the truth. And I used to exemplify with that. If I have asked 10 different people who are technically skilled and work with ZLD one way or the other, and ask them, what is the best way of setting up a ZLD system? What different steps and in what order and so on? I will get 10 different answers. So there's not one best available technique, there's not one best practice, and that's part of the nature of the problem. But that is also contributing to the confusion and the cost for trial and error at the expense of those factories. So they have really been in a very, very tricky situation here. And I do understand if they feel like we have tried our best, very many of them say, and some of them got bad advice at an early stage, and they were locked into a certain infrastructure system, which is costing them a lot now. They need to stick to it. And then maybe if you look at some new factories that are coming up in other parts of the country where they choose to go ZLD because of water scarcity, so their incentive is different. Because the incentive in Tirupur was that the dilution effect of the oil wasn't there, according to the court. The court, of course, never took into account whether you can actually just use an injection well. So that's not really officially in the picture. But I think that if you set up things like more efficiently with the modern technique that we have now and use low water, low salt dyes, for instance, there's a lot to be gained. And there are advances every day coming from R&D and better techniques coming from the time. So I
certainly for ages.
Oh my God.
So thank you for your attention. Do you have any questions? No? Okay, let's stop. No.
Anything that comes to mind? About your standards, I mean, if there are so many standards, and if their buyers are in Europe, and if there's a high demand for meeting certain standards, it's kind of obvious that only the very large producers are going to be able to meet those standards, but small manufacturers are going to be out of business. Has that happened? I mean, has that been one of the reasons why some of the businesses have gone out of
No, that's an interesting thought, really. But it seems like some domestic customers don't ask for certified foods. And some, like Western buyers, they ask, but there are still a lot of Western buyers that don't ask. But it's an interesting thought. But what I actually have heard a lot of dyers say is that we are running according to Ecotex or that standard. So we are doing the thing, but we don't want to cover audit costs and the membership costs. We're doing the things, but we don't want to take the cost. So I left the certified market segment, so to speak, by their own will. So that's kind of interesting. Because there are still you can sell to the non-certified.
On the other hand, I have heard very many producers say that the certificate, this, that, you get it in a day. You buy it somewhere. So they don't trust any other who has a certificate.
Your story actually seems more like a story of corruption than this one. Because entrenched in everything, it seems to be the underlying platform. You can't direct yourself in, but everything around it seems to be.
So
I had one more question for you, Jenny. When you say the suppliers are reusing groundwater, or you suspect that they're groundwater which is creating faulty colors, wouldn't then the manufacturers have some sort of incentive to rather invest in pipe water supply or backup supply, which is, because it might be really expensive, or is it like just a one-time upgrade that has happened now?
Very good question again. We don't really know yet, because this information, to the extent that I have it, it's come from various different sources, and I haven't been able, no diver is going to admit to us that that is what they do. Because most of them, they fully well know that this is not, is not okay. It is actually prohibited. And they do it only as long as the PCB is not requiring them to actually put a stop to it, as long as they can actually like cost benefit out the bribe that they need to pay for this or get away
from it.
But I also think they don't understand that it is the different types of groundwater from this source one day, from that source, that place the other day. I don't think, unless you have a skilled dive master, you won't understand that it is the TDS level different in the different raw water sources that causes. That is the, I mean, that's my best.
I mean, easy way to test it would be to see if they have made the same mistake a couple of times and see that. But we have to continue to ask this, about that.
Yeah, so we didn't need to get more information.
I have almost the same question, but really just what Vibha was saying, you know, TDS is pretty cheap to monitor. And I was wondering if the solution lies there. You could kind of educate people saying, all you need to do is, say, you know, 10,000 rupees or something. And all you need to do is take this thing and measure it and then show them that they themselves will benefit and have you created a way for them.
Yeah,
because finding solutions here seems almost exhausting.
Exactly. And when I came with my pre-understanding from the SWAR project, I really thought that it wouldn't be so difficult to get to this like discussion and like sit eye to eye. And I do that from time to time and say that, oh, so I hear that you have so many RO filters. Have you thought of the ultra filter before this? Because then you can lower your cost. And then you're like, you see how they're thinking, oh, okay, I should go back and speak to my guys about this. Because they wouldn't know those who I need to talk to. And likewise with the TDS, they don't necessarily know what TDS is, how you measure it, why it is important. Because, for instance, I asked about, when I heard this, that possibly NTADCL was actually supplying groundwater last year. Someone told me, and he expressed it in terms of, it wasn't sweet. So that is the terminology. It wasn't sweet. So okay, so did you pre-treat this? And I think he said yes, of course we did. So but that was a high-end export business.
So the immediate clarification question I had was is it the court which mandated that they should do only NTADCL order?
Yeah. 2012.
What's the incentive of the court to for the input side? The court is only interested in the knowledge charge, right? Or mandate what kind of water they use.
Sorry, it was not the court.
I suspect it's the government of Tamil Nadu.
Yes, of course.
Under pressure from NTADCL because you don't have any buyers.
PWD, of course. And those who pressured that for that was the other hat of NTADCL.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, not a court, of course, yes.
So, that makes it clear the incentives don't match. I mean, for a unit, dying unit cost is input cost is an important constraint. And if they can get slight, on the quality side, then they just do it till the buyer catches them and say, ask them to repeat the order or redo the order and so on. So, I mean, if you know what's the level of rejects, there might be some indication of how.
But it seems as if the PCB was checking this more rigorously until just a few years back, so that everyone were forced to take the NTADCL as through the pipes as well.
So that link with the drought last year may have been that if NTADCL itself didn't have enough Kaveri water to supply.
Could have been.
That would have been the reason, and not really enforcement as such. It's really that they don't have enough Kaveri water because it was bad year.
But I, as far as I understand, the shortage for NTADCL, because they have a profession, they have a certain volume that they are entitled to draw every day. And we will never find out how much they are actually drawing, how much they are restricting to the units that they have contracts with. If that number is increasing or decreasing over the years, and how many other businesses that they are selling water to now, which, from what I understand, is not part of that original concession that they have. So we know for a fact that they're supplying to schools, for instance, and other agribusinesses. And at the expense of tail-ender users, and at the expense of other users that could share them on the water.
My bigger question was actually your framework. So you started off with this research question, which is very, I mean, the question is clear, is the report, you know, going towards sustainable development part? Mm. That's your question.
Well, for this presentation.
Fair enough. And your method was sort of primarily what we distributed. But what you didn't tell us is your framework, theoretical framework. So, because for example, the research on standards, right? I mean, we were just doing some green certification discussion in class today. And there's a big literature on whether green certification will work or not and under what conditions. It's fairly obvious that transaction costs are the biggest concern in all green certification, whether it is CDM certification, whether it is organic product, you know, agriculture, in every context. The transaction costs involved in monitoring and certifying
yeah.
that a particular producer is meeting some standard, and of course the fragmentation of standard, etc. This is fairly well developed literature. So I was kind of wondering what is the theoretical perspective within which you are or which you are using to answer the question.
So for these two papers that are out, for the first one, as I presented at the EMC conference, the transition theory was being used to track the uptake, the development of the uptake of the ZWS method. So that is the theoretical framework for that. And for the paper on the ZWD reform process, command and control was successful, kind of theoretical. But we didn't go into that at all today because.
Certification issues here. Have you been into transformative development?
No.
Because we have been talking a little bit about that. Transition theory or transformation
theory? And transformation theory basically draws on transition theory.
Very nice to have the opportunity to come here. Thank you for your
continuous support.
Yes, and yours.
Thank you.